Hi everyone, my name is Tejas Chopra and I am a senior software engineer at Netflix. Today I'll be presenting compression, deduplication and encryption conundrums in cloud. I am very excited to be a part of the Data Innovation Summit 2021. The agenda for the talk is as follows. We'll go over a brief introduction about myself, what I do. We'll go over some cloud basics that explain how cloud is designed today and used by enterprises. Then we'll get into the explanation of these three technologies, compression, deduplication, and encryption. We'll get into the right order of applying them when designing for the cloud, and finally, some takeaways and learnings from the process. I'm a senior software engineer at Netflix. I work on creating and architecting infrastructure and storage solutions for exabyte scale data and billions of assets generated by Netflix studios and streaming platforms. Along with that, I'm also an international keynote speaker. I talk on distributed systems, cloud, and blockchain. I was a senior software engineer at Box, where again, I was working on cloud storage technologies to support millions of customers and petabytes of data. I have worked at companies such as Datrium, Samsung, Cadence, and Apple. Coming into compression, deduplication, and encryption, and what they mean. Now, the first thing is, let us understand the cloud basics. So a lot of enterprises are entering the cloud storage market, and the footprint of data in the cloud is exponentially increasing. And the reason why enterprises go with cloud is because of manageability, which means that they focus on their business deliverables and not on maintaining infrastructure. They rely on the cloud provider to manage the infrastructure for them. The second is scalability. So as you get more requests from customers, you would like your infrastructure to scale and take that load. And that becomes very easy with cloud. And the third is pay per use. You only pay for services that you use in cloud. Cloud gives you a bunch of services out of the box if you're using Amazon, Google, or Microsoft. And that allows you to build systems on top of that. The other interesting part of cloud is that a lot of startups have come up that try to model the costs of cloud, of using cloud. And the reason is that the cost modeling in cloud is a bit complicated. A very simple example is when you try to upload a file to cloud. You would think that uploading a file would mean that the cost that you pay for storing the file on cloud. However, it gets more interesting than that. There is a per request cost that is associated with sending a put request to cloud. There's a cost with storing the data itself on cloud. And finally, there is a cost to read the data out of cloud back. And if you can imagine that with hundreds of petabytes of data at Box and with exabyte scale data at Netflix, if such systems are not designed correctly, that may mean millions, or in case of Netflix, billions of dollars of money put into the cloud storage just to read the data out of cloud. Traditionally, on-premise file systems have addressed the need to reduce the footprint of data by leveraging technologies such as compression and deduplication. And let us see if we can apply a subset of these technologies along with encryption to reduce the footprint of data on cloud. In general, enterprises, when they try to reduce the cloud bill, will focus on either right sizing or choosing the right instance for their workload, having reserved instances instead of spot instances, and finally, exploring storage. In this talk, we will try to focus on the third parameter here, which is exploring storage to see if we can reduce the cloud costs for enterprises. Compression is an ability to reduce the size of the data and compress it using techniques such as LZ4, LZIP, and GZIP. Some of them are lossy techniques and some of them are lossless techniques. One thing to note is that not all data is compressible. For example, images are not, media files are not. So if you're storing media files on cloud, you can already assume that compression will not give you a lot of benefits. The other thing to note is that there is generally some form of overhead when you're compressing data. And this overhead is in terms of both latency and memory. So you have to accumulate some data, put it in one place, and then compress it and then send it to cloud. And that is generally the latency overhead that we are talking about. It may not be so pronounced in cases where you want to store files and folders. But for cases where you are actually designing systems that deal with images and media files, or streaming data in general, you may not want to have this overhead. I have seen that at Box, which when we were typically storing text files and folders, we saw that compression gave us more than 5x the returns. So this is a small diagram that shows that there is some raw data, you compress it, and finally you deduplicate the data and you've reduced the footprint of the data eventually. coming back to the basics of deduplication, deduplication is an ability to firstly understand that two files or two assets or two images are duplicates of each other and then remove a duplicate copy. The way it is done is you actually end up storing only one copy in the cloud backend and you hand references to that copy to different users or applications. But deduplication means that you have to now be careful with deleting the deduplicated file. Because multiple applications are sharing the file, even if one application tries to delete the file, you must not delete the file. Other applications may still be reading or using it. So you need to maintain some form of reference counting on the backend to know how many references are handed out. And only when the reference count goes to zero, would you want to delete the file. So how do you check for duplicates before you actually store the file is an interesting question. And there are two ways to check for duplicates. One of them is online deduplication. In this case, you actually check for the duplicate of the file before even sending the file to cloud. So you have to manage some state on your machine or your client, which has some form of hashes of the files that are already stored in cloud. And if the hash of the current file that is being streamed to cloud matches the hashes that are already there in that pool, there is no need to send the file. You would only want to increase the reference count of the existing file in cloud. The other one is offline deduplication. In this strategy, enterprises end up sending the file to cloud. And then there is a background thread or a daemon that runs in cloud that compares different files and their hashes and removes the duplicate files and increases the reference count of the existing files. Generally, I have seen enterprises start with offline deduplication because online deduplication is a bit complicated with a lot of state management. So far, I've been talking about deduplicating at the file granularity. Imagine Netflix that stores its movies on cloud. The movies themselves may run into gigabytes. And actually, if you just edit a small portion of the movie, that would mean that your file would not deduplicate now because it has been changed. So in order to get around this, what we do at Netflix is we actually deduplicate at chunk level granularities. So instead of deduplication happening at a file level, we split a file into multiple chunks and then we deduplicate chunks. So that means that in such a scenario, 90% of the chunks would actually remain common and only 10% would be unique chunks. That gives us a lot of advantage in terms of reducing our cloud footprint. The other thing is that at enterprises such as Box, a deduplication domain was an organization, which means you could only deduplicate content within an enterprise and not across enterprises. This is done for security reasons. So a good way to look at it is you have some data in your data store. You generate hash values for each piece of data. And then the hash values are compared to identify the duplicates. As you can see here, there are multiple copies of one particular data here. Finally, you replace the duplicates with pointers to save the storage space. Coming to the third technology, encryption. One of the reasons that cloud providers have focused a lot on security is because enterprises have always felt that cloud is less secure than on-premise. So encryption is a first-class citizen in a lot of cloud provider offerings. Encryption implies obfuscating the data to avoid unauthorized access on the wire or at rest. Encryption over the wire is actually solved by TLS. There are two strategies that are generally employed by enterprises when they're using encryption. One of them is client-side encryption, where the client actually encrypts the content before it sends it over the wire to the server or the cloud. The other is server-side encryption, where the client sends plain text bytes over the wire. The over-the-wire encryption is solved by TLS, so the bytes are actually encrypted on the wire. And once the bytes land on the server also encrypts the content and stores it locally. So you can use any of them. But I have seen that enterprises such as Netflix and Box generally prefer using client-side encryption where they control the encryption keys and encrypt the content before sending it to cloud. The other thing to note is, like I discussed, at Netflix, some file sizes are often greater than the maximum supported size on cloud providers. So we have a layer on top of S3, which chunks the file into smaller pieces, and each chunk is separately encrypted with a new encryption key, and we upload them to cloud. The other interesting part about encryption is that once you encrypt the data, you cannot apply deduplication or compression because encrypted content is not compressible and it is very rarely dedupable. So just to highlight, S3 encryption provides in-flight encryption using SSL API endpoints, and it provides at-rest encryption. Here you can use the client-side encryption where clients will encrypt your data before sending to S3. or server side encryption, where you can completely use S3 server side encryption technology, use a key management service along with S3, and have your client side encrypt the data, but store the keys on S3 or on the cloud. Now, coming back to how would you like to order these technologies to get the best benefit? The first rule is to encrypt last. The reason is that if you've encrypted your data, you cannot compress or deduplicate data. So if you have enterprises that use client-side encryption, which is the preferred technology, then that means you actually want to employ online deduplication, which means deduplicating content before sending it to cloud, and also use compression on the client side. This means that the design can get a bit complicated because online deduplication has a lot of state management. The other thing is today at Netflix, we encrypt each chunk with a separate encryption key, but we are exploring technologies where we can manage a single or maintain a single encryption key per pool of objects instead of per object. And this has implications on deduplication, because now that means that if two chunks are similar, and even after encryption, they will actually be deduplicated because they are encrypted using the same key. So their content will remain the same. It also has implications on security, because now you are inherently less secure by maintaining a single key per pool of objects rather than a single key per object. The second rule is to deduplicate first. So you want to employ online deduplication because you want to encrypt and compress the data before you send it to cloud. Now, before the data is streamed, the way to know that there's a duplicate that exists on cloud is to maintain a global pool of fingerprints, which are hashes of data. So you compare your current object or chunk's fingerprint with the fingerprints that are present in this pool. And if the fingerprint is already present, you have no need to stream the data to cloud. You will just increase the reference count of the fingerprint and return a reference to the cloud copy. So that is how you will try to deduplicate first. And the reason you try to deduplicate first is because compression algorithms can change in the future. So by deduping first, you're protecting yourself against any change in the algorithms in the future. Now, bringing all of these together, if we want to think of an optimum write flow and a system that uses a hybrid model of an on-premise system and cloud, and the reason we go with on-premise system is because this will help remove your egress cost. So you will just read from on-premise instead of cloud when data is present. You can think of on-premise system as a cache for the cloud tier. So when a file is being uploaded, you would first try to deduplicate the file. And that means you will look at a global fingerprint table, you will hash the file and check if the fingerprint exists in this table. If the fingerprint exists in this table, you will just return a reference to the client saying that the write is done. And if it doesn't exist, you would insert a placeholder in this fingerprint table, compress the data locally, and write the compressed bits to local storage. Finally, you would encrypt the data at the point of the cloud upload. Once the file has been uploaded to cloud and is present in the cloud bucket, you would update your fingerprint table to reflect the location in cloud. So this is how a typical write would work. Now, in such a scenario, how would a read work? So in the case of read, you would always want to read the content from your on-premise system. And only if the content is not present in the on-premise system because of either eviction or because it's a cold start, you will then try to fetch the content from cloud and hydrate your on-premise system. Assuming that it is a cold start, which means that this is the first time you're fetching the content, you will first check the location of the file in the cloud storage. You will then fetch the data from the cloud bucket. This data will be encrypted and a compressed object. And this would then be first decrypted and stored in your local storage. These are compressed bits that you store in local storage. And then finally, you would decompress the data and mark the read as successful. Subsequent read requests for the file will be served from the local storage because it's already hydrated. So here are some takeaways and learnings from this process. One is that not all data is compressible, and compression actually adds some form of latency, as we discussed. So you can explore removing the step of compression depending on the nature of your data. Many organizations such as Box first store the data on-premise and then they upload it to cloud. This saves egress costs. And the other reason is many files are sometimes temporary in nature, which means that these files are ephemeral and they will not actually make it to the final cut. In case of Netflix, there are artists that work on data that is work in progress, and they do not want that data to be in the final cut or movie. So they will work on on-premise systems, and only when the data is ready for publishing will it be published to cloud. Encryption is applied at the point of uploads so that you have the ability to do compression and deduplication before that. Online deduplication is tough. It deals with a lot of state management, reference counting, concurrent accesses that need a lot of locking primitives in place. So I have seen typically companies start off with offline deduplication to get some deduplication benefits and then move to online deduplication. That's my time. Thank you so much for being a part of this session. Please feel free to reach out to me on LinkedIn, Twitter, and email address. Thank you.